Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting in 2024 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. We've received an apology today from Jeremy Balfour, MSP. I'd like to also remind everyone to please switch off or put to silent your mobile phones and other electronic devices. The first item of business is to decide whether to take item 6 in private. Is the committee content to take this item in private? Under agenda item number 2, we're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft rural development, continuation of operation, miscellaneous amendment, Scotland Regulations 2024, and the draft Scotland Act 1998, specification of devolved tax, building safety, order 2024. Is the committee content with these instruments? Under agenda item number 3, we're considering instruments subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSIs 2024, 229, 230, 233, 236, 237, 238, 239 and 240. Is the committee content with these instruments? Under agenda item number 4, we're considering instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSIs 2024, 231 and 232. Is the committee content with these instruments? Under agenda item number 5, we are taking evidence from Marie Goujon, MSP, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands on the Land Reform of Scotland Bill. The Cabinet Secretary is accompanied by 3 Scottish Government officials. Fiona Leslie, the Head of Agricultural Holdings and Women in Agriculture Team, Andy Crawley, the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and Andy Proudfoot, the Land Reform Bill Team Leader. I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting this morning. I'd also particularly like to welcome back to the committee Andy Proudfoot, who was previously the clerk to the committee. And it's very nice to see you again, Andy, and albeit very much on the other side of the table this time round. So first of all, I just want to invite Tim Eagle to say something.
Thank you, Convener. It's just to remind members that I am a small farmer myself and I've previously worked for Scottish Land and Estates. That's in my registry of interests and I just want to make sure everyone's aware of that this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. So first, I'd like to remind all attendees not to worry about switching on the microphones because they'll be undertaken for you. So first of all, I want to invite the Cabinet Secretary to say any opening remarks. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener and Committee Members. And thank you for the opportunity to speak to the Committee on the Delegated Powers in the Land Reform Bill. I am committed to working with members to ensure that we are delivering good law. I know that members will have a range of questions on the powers, but I think I just want to make a couple of opening comments to give some background to the overall approach to this bill. As set out in the Delegated Powers Memorandum, the overarching policy objectives of the bill are to help realise our vision for land reform and sustainable and regenerative agriculture. And the bill therefore covers the ongoing management and transfer of large land holdings. It will also help to secure the viability of tenant farming and enable tenant farmers and small landholders to participate in delivering our vision for agriculture. And specifically, the bill covers 4 principal policy areas: land reform, new land management tenancy, agricultural holdings legislation, and small landholding legislation. As I outlined in my response to the committee's initial questions, I want to ensure that the bill provides that correct balance between primary and secondary legislation so that the key measures are on the face of the bill and there is that proper scrutiny for the measures made under the bill. So with that, I really welcome the views of the committee as well as from stakeholders more widely to ensure that the bill strikes that correct balance.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Cabinet Secretary. So we've divided the questions up into various themes. So the questions will come kind of in blocks like that. And so the first theme the committee is asking about is the issue of policy development. And we are particularly discussing the powers to be found at Schedule paragraphs 44, 49, 5, 50, 7 and 59, as well as sections 10, 11 and 12. In relation to a number of the delegated powers, as confirmed in your response that you just touched upon, very little policy development discussions have taken place on issues such as the assessment of compensation and also the right to buy. Can you please provide some context as to why those discussions have not yet taken place and haven't been carried out at an earlier stage in the planning of the bill?
I think in relation to a number of the measures that you've set out there, put out our overall approach and rationale within the policy memorandum itself. But we recognise with a number of different areas here that the work needs to be ongoing, where we've picked up particular issues. There are areas that we're hearing through evidence that we still want to work through with our stakeholders. I don't know if it would be valuable to touch on some of the areas of work that have been undertaken so far. And I'll just pass to Fiona Leslie, who's been working closely, particularly in relation to the small landing holdings legislation, proposals in that area, and the agricultural tenancies.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. Morning, everyone. So in relation to compensation, we've been exploring the range of issues at play in how compensation will be calculated. Now, given the fluctuations around global forces, some of the elements around compensation are quite subjective at the point of valuation. So things like steel, which goes on a monthly global price fluctuation, things like the activities that the government is willing to pay for in terms of support, so peatland management, restoration, all of that will factor into how compensation values will be calculated for small landholders. So we are working with stakeholders, and we've already started exploring the range of options around that. So we've had initial discussions with SAVA and CAV around the tenant farming assessment on compensation. We're going to have more detailed conversations with them. It's important that the flexibility is there in the secondary legislation to enable the framework around that to be developed in a way that is adaptive enough, so we don't have to revert to primary every time a new development of activity comes forward, because that is the reason why we made some of the other changes in the bill in part two in relation to the tenant farming, because we've put a lot on primary around tenant farming that we're now hamstrung the tenants on. So we want to ensure we do not inadvertently do that with the small landholders and their landlords. The other point that's important about the valuation assessment for the landlord's interests, particularly for small landholders, is so that the landlord, if the small landholder has done something that requires compensation payment to be made to the landlord, that we develop the process enough that it's fair for both sides and it's equitable. And the key thing on that is it being equitable. So the intention is that we will create a framework followed up with guidance with the TFC, and that will then provide a more comprehensive way of undertaking valuations. We've attended the SAVA and CAV field day, which was exceptionally helpful, where they ran through sort of compensation assessments and their methodologies with a group of about 40 people. So that was incredibly helpful to us to see how things would be valued on the ground and the practical approach taken by them. Now, some of that is built on the RICS valuation methodology and the valuation process that they set out in their professional guidance. So, and also some of that is down to regional and local fluctuations. So when we're building the SSI around that, we need to take account of all these factors to be fair and proportionate for both sides. In relation to right to buy, moving on to that, we have been engaging with ROS around Registers of Scotland in relation to their assessment of the level of data required to make the process more transparent. And we've had a range of stakeholder views around the degree of information required about right to buy. And that varies from a sheet of paper with no map or a map that looks like a line on a map. So if you go onto the Register of Community Interest, you can see in some of the older documents, you can literally see a piece of A4 with a couple of squiggly lines and a tree written on it, to a detailed ordnance survey map at different scales. So we need to have an in-depth discussion with ROS about what's proportionate for them and also with our stakeholders, so to try and encapsulate all interests but make it proportionate, and also to make sure it's not overly bureaucratic in terms of the development of what's required and the minimum requirements versus the maximum. I hope that answers your questions.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. That's quite detailed on the both points. See, just on the compensation aspect, so you mentioned a range of individuals and organisations you've spoken to so far. Are they content with the approach that has been taken in the bill, or have they raised any concerns with what's been proposed in the bill?
So obviously there's a range of views from a range of stakeholders with a range of acting on behalf of a range of interested member bodies, and the views have not always been supportive, depending on the organisation. The key players in this have to be RICS and SAVA and CAV, because they are the ones that will be doing the technical evaluations on the ground, and they are the experts in this field. So we plan to lean heavily on them, because they will be the practitioners of this on the ground. So the intention is that we will have a working group with them and then test it through the Tenant Farming Advisory Forum, which is our main route to testing methodologies such as these, so we can ensure that all stakeholders have a fair voice at the table, and they are, and it's an open voice, so that they can, we can try and reach consensus where possible, but also acknowledge that there will be occasions where some member organisations, for their members' interests, will not be able to fully agree to something that other members may want to.
Okay, well, thank you. So there are obvious risks associated with legislating before policy is fully developed, and what considerations has been given to the challenges this actually creates for proper parliamentary scrutiny, and also what, if anything, has been put in place in order to reduce those risks and support scrutiny, despite the lack of policy development?
Well, I would say a number of the delegated powers that we're proposing are affirmative instruments, which I think allows for the appropriate level of parliamentary scrutiny as part of that process. But I would just say that we obviously wouldn't be developing policy in a vacuum. I think Fiona's just touched on some of the extensive engagement that's taken place with some stakeholders so far. There's no doubt we are dealing with, in some cases, some really antiquated pieces of legislation that are very complex. I think we can probably gather that, I think, from just the extent of the legislation that we're bringing forward and some of the areas that we're dealing with as well. But of course, I think just in terms of how we formulate policy, of course, it's absolutely critical to us that we undertake that wide engagement. We consult with the people who are going to be affected by the instruments that we would be bringing forward as well, to ensure that we are making informed decisions. And of course, as we bring forward secondary legislation, how we've undertaken the work that we have undertaken would be set out in the various accompaniments to that legislation as well, and the various impact assessments that we would have to produce. So we would be setting that out quite clearly. But it's clearly within our best interest to be working with a wide variety of different stakeholders as we bring forward legislation, though notwithstanding the point that Fiona has made as well. Obviously, there are very different views on some of the policy approaches that we're taking.
Okay, no, thank you. Just in terms of the affirmative aspect, have you ruled out any additional instruments coming forward in the future that will actually be affirmative, or do you think that you've got the balance right so far in terms of the level of affirmative and in contrast to others?
I certainly believe that the balance we have at the moment is the correct one, which is why what I set out in my response to the committee itself. But of course, I'm more than happy to hear the views on the committee in relation to the different instruments as well, and I'm open to considering whatever feedback members may have.
And what are the plans and the timescales for the ongoing policy development discussions with the stakeholders?
I mean, obviously, a lot of that work is ongoing at the moment. We've already set out to the Net Zero Committee that we are working on the small landholding provisions and intending to bring forward more amendments in relation to that. But of course, if there are going to be any impacts in this committee and its scrutiny, then we will keep you informed.
Well, thank you. Thank you. And Tim Eagle.
Very much. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. I think I'm moving on to just talking about consultation within the bill. So there's been some concerns, I think, around that there is not a statutory legal consultation within the bill, that you've sort of suggested that that's under your general obligations as a government. Why have you chosen that? Because obviously in some previous bills there's been an explicit statutory need to consult. So can you just talk us around that?
I think it's important that we take an approach that's not it can't be a one-size-fits-all when it comes to consultation. I do think some of the proposals that we're bringing forward would be technical in their nature, or maybe could be administrative changes as well. So therefore, it wouldn't be proportionate, I think, to carry out a statutory full public consultation in relation to some of those measures. So that's where, in relation to some of the different instruments that we have in the bill, that there is more of that variety there. I mean, there are some areas where we've set out specifically who we would be intending to consult with. So if you look, for example, section 10, where we have included a duty to consult the keeper and those likely to have an interest in registration, there's also section 23, where we'd be consulting such persons as are considered appropriate for that, as well as a variety of other instruments that are in the bill as well. But I would just want to set out and be clear to the committee more broadly that we do have a general duty to consult. I think I may have set this out in my letter, but we've published Right First Time, which is the guide to decision making and the law. And step two of that sets out the process that we have to undertake. And it also sets out how a decision might be unlawful if failure to consult means that we're not in possession of the information that we need to make a rational decision. So it could then be unlawful for us not to have consulted throughout that process. So that's where, again, just as I've highlighted, when we're bringing forward secondary legislation, we would be setting out in the various impact assessments who we've engaged with, what the outcome of that was, as well as looking at the various impacts. But I do think that it is hugely important for us to undertake that engagement with stakeholders. I think it's key to any of the policies that we bring forward. But I do think that tailored approach that we have, and with a variety of different instruments that we've introduced, is quite important, and making sure that's proportionate for each instrument that's brought forward.
Okay. Given, Scottish Lands and Estates wrote to the committee with concerns over the consultation, because there is quite significant aspects to this bill which could significantly offend some of their clients, but more broadly in the agricultural sector. So I guess it's going back to that point, isn't it, of you're absolutely right, you don't need that full public consultation, but to at least have in there guarantee to anybody that's going to be affected by any secondary legislation that the interested parties will be consulted. So would you be adverse to that coming forward at a later stage of the bill?
Again, I'm more than happy to consider that. And I think when I'm taken through other pieces of legislation through the Scottish Parliament, that's been part of the discussion that we've had as well, as to what the appropriate level of consultation for each of the powers within that is. So again, I'm more than happy to consider the committee's views in relation to the instruments that we've set out and what we've set out in relation to the consultation for that. But I do just think it is important to highlight, and to highlight to other stakeholders as well, that we do have that general duty to consult, whether or not it's specified within the legislation.
Yes, but in previous bills that has been explicit, whereas in this one we're talking about the general. Is that a change then in an approach to these bills moving forward, or is that just...
No, it's not a change.
Okay.
No, that has been the case previously, yep, as well.
Okay, fine. Okay, I think that covers them all anyway.
Okay. Thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. I don't need to do that, do I? Thank you very much. It's just because you've covered quite a bit there, actually, but in respect of a number of the powers, the committee have asked why the powers have not been more narrowly drafted, and I think that was addressed there, in greater detail provided. You responded that this has not been possible and the circumstances in which these powers might be used are not yet clear, and will depend on the operation of the bill once it's enacted. Well, the committee understands the need for some inbuilt flexibility if you're unable to identify the circumstances and the powers being used in the bill. But why do you consider it's appropriate then to have these powers at all, please?
Well, obviously there are a variety of different powers within the bill as it's been introduced, and I think I hope I've been clear in setting out, both within the delegate powers memorandum and also in my response to the committee, why we have taken the powers that we have and the extent to which they apply, and explained the rationale for that as well. I mean, some of the powers that we've introduced do mirror other powers that exist in previous pieces of legislation. And in some cases, it's a read across to make sure that we have the same powers in place and that we have the same rules applying to, say, smallholders, as an example, as we do to some other tenancies. So I think it's really important that we have that there. But of course, some of the powers that we have could have unintended consequences or knock-on consequences elsewhere. So I do believe that we've drafted them in the correct way for the powers that we are looking to have. But of course, I'm happy to look at any particular concerns that the committee might have if there are particular powers that you have in mind where that's more of an issue.
Okay, thanks. Well, you've stated anyway that land reform is a process rather than an event, basically. So what's your response to the view that it might be better to look at any future changes as the picture becomes clearer and bring these back in a future bill, allowing for further parliamentary scrutiny at that point?
I think it's because it's also important that I think we learn the lessons of pieces of legislation that have come before this bill too. I do think that's absolutely correct. Land reform is a journey, and no doubt there will be further land reform bills after this one as well, because we are looking at a number of areas of new policy that has been informed from previous pieces of legislation, from that engagement with stakeholders that I've already outlined too. So I do think the powers that we're bringing forward, we want to deliver on our vision for land reform in Scotland and to really try and tackle some of the issues of scale and concentration of land ownership. I mean, the proposals that we brought forward are based on the work of the Scottish Land Commission, and I think it is really important that we deliver on those ambitions and we take that other step forward. I mean, of course, there are new areas of policy within this bill. The monitoring that we undertake as we go forward and as these are introduced, if they are all agreed to by the Parliament, that monitoring work will be really critical and will help inform any proposed regulations that stem from that or any future legislation as well. So the monitoring will be critical. But I don't think we can hold off on introducing new policy or new legislation necessarily. I think it is a huge, a really important step forward that we've introduced this bill. And I think that some of the changes within it, it's vital that happens now. When I mentioned earlier about how antiquated some of the small landholding legislation is, we really need to update some of the areas in relation to agricultural tenancies as well, so that we can deliver on our agriculture ambitions, as I outlined in my opening comments. And we can only do that through the introduction of the measures that we've got.
Okay, thank you. Now, if you don't mind, a wee bit of specificity, if I can get that word out, in terms of how this actually will affect some people. Scottish Land and Estates have stated in their correspondence with us in the committee that these powers create unnecessary uncertainty that would have a detrimental impact on land markets, and that making law but reserving the right to change it at any time is unsettling for businesses and unhelpful when businesses want to plan for the long term. I mean, do you have a response to that, that view? And do you accept that the lack of specificity on the face of the bill leaves future operation of the law unclear by those affected by it?
I think there are some elements of that I would disagree with, because I do think that it's important, as I've just outlined, that we need to be able to monitor and respond to changes as well. So there are some instruments that we would be intending to bring forward here that can help us move with agricultural policy as that develops, in terms of some of the measures that we might look to add at various points in the future. So I think we need to be able to react and to respond to the monitoring as it comes forward. But I understand the concerns that have been raised, like you say, by SLE, but I think we have tried to set out as much detail as we can within the bill. But of course, I think it's also important, just as I've outlined, we need to be able to be flexible and respond to any potential changes in the future, which is why I think the powers that we have are so important.
So it's actually quite early days in some ways for some of the elements which are going in here. But they're quite wide powers, actually, and policy development has got a long way to go yet. What are you doing as a Scottish Government to make sure that there's clear legislation and allowing for proper parliamentary scrutiny of the bill?
I think that is really important, and that's why I say largely the instruments that we've set out, I think the vast majority of them are affirmative measures, because we want to make sure that there is that appropriate parliamentary scrutiny. So I do believe in terms of what we've set out, we've got the balance of that right, and we want to make sure that people have their say as we're developing these proposals. I've already set out in terms of the consultation how we would intend to do that. But I think that parliamentary scrutiny is important. And again, I think in terms of the instruments that we've set out and the powers that we'd be proposing to take, I believe that we have got the balance of that right.
Well, thank you very much for that. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. And Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much, convener.
I just really wanted to
go on to the area around sort of the fundamental concepts and powers. So we have identified three areas in particular, but I think this probably extends to some other things that colleagues have already mentioned. So particularly section 1, subsection 4, section 2, subsection 4, and section 4, subsection 2, which essentially give the power to the government to alter quite fundamental concepts, which would alter who it would be in scope in terms of exercising the right to buy, the requirements on consultation. This potentially impacts the timelines and even really who is able to exercise these powers. So I was just wondering if, Cabinet Secretary, you could explain why it's necessary to leave such fundamental concepts open in terms of the primary legislation and leaving that to secondary.
Yes, obviously you've outlined quite a number of powers within that there that are doing various things to various degrees. So I think...
I'm not asking you to explain each one. It's the broad principle to it's basically leaving the scope and process so open in terms of the primary legislation, why that's necessary.
As I've just outlined, though, obviously the number of instruments that you'd outlined there are looking to do various things to various degrees. I hope I've been able to outline in some of my previous responses why the powers are proposed in the way that they are, and potentially why some of them can't really be drafted more narrowly is because of the impacts that they could have in other parts of the bill, potential unintended consequences that we have too. Now, some of the powers that you've listed within there, it's about looking at whether that's the land threshold, reporting breaches in relation to that as well, who can report breaches. I think all of these we need to be able to monitor and update as we progress. And again, I think in relation to the powers that could modify the land threshold, first of all, there would be parliamentary scrutiny of the use of these powers. But again, and touching on my previous response too, we need to be able to be flexible in the future to be able to monitor. I mean, some of these are new areas of policy. We need to look at how they're working, how they're embedding. We could see issues with some areas further down the line, potentially if we see routes that are being used for avoidance that maybe we want to try and address later. When we look at some of the exemptions that apply within this as well, again, it would be beneficial to be able to look at through secondary legislation whether we need to add more to the exemptions, whether we need to limit exemptions. So the power to be able to look at that and respond, I think, is hugely important. And again, why we've set out the powers and proposed the powers in the way that we have.
Can I ask you just a very narrow question and then some ones that follow from that? I mean, presumably the government thinks this is going to be a substantial and permanent change, and one that will take the direction of travel in terms of land from any particular direction. Would that be a fair thing to surmise?
Yes, I certainly hope so.
So given that, and given the wide flexibility you hear, and it's in your own words, that's flexible, is there not a risk that actually it almost lays open the reverse? Now, obviously this is democracy. Administrations change, and therefore, let's just say hypothetically that in 10 years' time the monopolist and large landowners' party comes to power. What stops them from essentially using these provisions to bring about effects that are actually entirely contrary to the intent of the legislation as you have presented it?
I think you raise a really important point, because I think that's the thing with the powers that we propose through legislation. It's not just about how this government intends to use them, it's for governments in years to come. But again, I would come back to, we need to be able to respond to changes in the future. We need to be able to tackle some issues that could arise that perhaps we haven't foreseen at the moment. So we need to ensure that we've got the flexibility. But alongside that, we also need to make sure that the scrutiny and that there are that the Parliament has the appropriate scrutiny powers within that too. Now, again, I do believe we have got the balance of that right, both in terms of what we are proposing and, like you say, our policy intentions at the moment. Of course, that could change with any potential government in future. But again, I would come back to that. I think we've got the balance of that right. But of course, that's where I'm keen to hear the views of committee members.
Potentially, this legislation would make it easier for a future government to, because it wouldn't need to use primary legislation to do something that is actually almost the 180-degree opposite to the intent that you are setting out here?
I wouldn't agree with that necessarily, because we're introducing the thresholds and the transfer test. I think fundamentally that wouldn't alter, though, of course, what land could form part of that, or how breaches are reported in various other areas that we've talked about could change.
So you've set the need for consultation and flexibility. Just wondering why, if you could explain why primary legislation would frustrate that, given that it might take longer, but still fundamentally would enable you to make changes. Critically, I mean, while you've said that there's a generalised obligation on the government to consult, obviously the degree to which we have an open and transparent consultation process is enhanced by Parliament. Indeed, that's Parliament's primary function. I just wonder why you think Parliament isn't the right place to consider future changes or undertake the consultation that might be required for future changes.
I wouldn't agree with that assessment. I do think it is entirely appropriate, and Parliament should have the appropriate powers of scrutiny over that. And that's where I think the instruments would enable and allow for that to happen. Now, I do think that what we've set out and what we'd be proposing in terms of the powers for secondary legislation are proportionate. I mean, some of the examples I've touched on already, where we're looking at exemptions. So if we were to see a route being used as an avoidance of specific measures, that's something we would want to address quite quickly, rather than perhaps or potentially having to wait for another opportunity to introduce primary legislation, which we know can take a long time to introduce and to effect any change. So I think, again, we believe we've got the balance in terms of where we need that flexibility and what we need to do. But I think that's where it's not always proportionate or appropriate to wait for primary legislation. And I think the areas and the instruments we proposed are where we would need that flexibility and where we anticipate that we would need to make those changes and be responsive to that in future.
I just ask you to acknowledge the fact, though, that while many of these things are set out in terms of affirmative procedure is not the same as primary legislation, primarily in that it's less likely that evidence will be taken, and more importantly, the ability for Parliament to amend is obviously not there at all. I'm just, would you acknowledge that is a pretty big difference between, you know, primary legislation and the affirmative procedure?
Obviously, there are differences there between primary and secondary legislation, but I would say it doesn't necessarily mean that committees can't take evidence. I mean, I've appeared in front of committees on negative instruments, as an example, and given evidence. And I know that committees can invite in, and they have those powers of scrutiny as well. So I think it's important to emphasise those points.
But obviously they can't amend. And I just also wanted to just ask you briefly about the... In your previous answers, you outlined the fact that you're in some areas just bringing the powers in line with other bits of legislation. Other than consistency with older pieces of legislation, just wondering if you could set out the rationale for bringing it into line and whether actually any impact assessment or analysis of whether or not those powers were appropriate. Obviously, it's possible for previous legislation to have got the balance wrong.
You're absolutely right, and I think we've got to consider each one on its merits, and it's not just been a case of transfer for transfer's sake. And I think some of the areas where it's important to highlight some of those measures are in relation to, as we discussed previously, the small landholdings legislation, where it's mirroring some of the legislation that we have in place for agricultural holdings, and that's to ensure that the people and the different tenancies are being treated in the same way. So I think that that's reflective of why mirroring some of those changes is important in legislation. But I don't know if there are any other specific examples that officials could touch on that would be helpful to illustrate that.
If I might just add, Cabinet Secretary, there's obviously some powers that you'll have seen that point or add the powers to the 2003 Land Reform Act, so it crosses over so that the powers in this Act are actually the procedure used is taken from or is added to the 2003 Act, because that's where we felt it was appropriate to slot in. So, yeah, it's been done on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah. Yes, and similarly with the lease reform, we've tried to take the same approach, both in relation to processes and also in relation to powers, because it's important, apart from anything else, that the law is understandable and foreseeable, that we're not making change for its own sake. So while I completely agree, that in itself is not a reason to do something, it is nonetheless something that we have regard to when we're framing powers and thinking about what will be fair to all the parties involved.
So, I've just got one final question. Oh gosh, there's a little bit of a boom there. So we're seeing a kind of a significant number of this sort of bill, framework bills, which have broadly stated intention, but the detail is largely left secondary. And the rationale of co-design is often given. Now, I think it is absolutely right that the government seeks to design legislation with as broad a range of stakeholders as possible. I think that makes sense. I just got one simple question. Why is it necessary to do that co-design following or in conjunction with legislation rather than doing it beforehand and actually baking it into the legislation itself so that Parliament can actually look at the full suite and the finished article rather than hoping that the government does the right kind of consultation and brings forward the right kind of secondary legislation?
I think, first of all, I disagree with your assessment that this is a framework bill. I certainly wouldn't... having taken through, just taken through the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Act earlier this year, which was more of a broad framework, again, that was an approach that the Parliament had agreed with, and I believe that this committee had agreed with as well, because we are going through a period of agricultural transition and how we're adapting our new framework and how we are implementing that over the course of the next few years. So that flexibility is again needed, not only to develop and design that future framework with our stakeholders, but also because, as we know with agriculture, there can be a variety of changes that happen over time, crises that we need to be able to respond to. So having the flexibility to do that and design that through secondary legislation is hugely important. But I think turning to this bill, which again I think is completely different, yes, there are a number of powers that we're proposing to take as part of it, but I certainly would not say that it is a framework bill. Again, we've talked about the appropriate levels of scrutiny throughout this. It's always important to remember that there will be parliamentary scrutiny through each of these instruments that we've introduced. And again, we've only taken those powers where we believe it's proportionate and appropriate as well. So I understand that there is work underway in relation to legislation that the government brings forward, but I think I just need to be clear on this bill itself and how it differs to some of those other pieces of legislation.
I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I've just got one final question, and that's just regarding the likes of the affirmative, but also the super affirmative procedure. Is that something that you would consider if the committee made some recommendations with regards to some of the powers?
Again, I believe what we've set out here is the appropriate balance and strikes that right balance with the powers that we are proposing to take. But of course, I'm happy to consider any recommendations the committee might make in relation to the instruments that we've introduced as part of this bill. I touched on some of the legislation I've taken through previously, where the feedback of the committee was very much taken on board and we considered that. So I'm more than happy to hear the recommendations.
OK, thank you. Tim Eagle.
Just a quick question. I'm still trying to get my head around a lot of this because I guess the problem with it, partly in the agricultural bill, but also in this one, is that there are significant changes that could happen. So there is uncertainty out there, isn't there, with some of the, whether that's the prohibition, modification of land, right to buy, et cetera, So, what happens in the background? What discussion, is there a sort of set of requirements that you have to look at that says, yeah, that is balanced to actually, we can take that power? Is there a set of rules that you guys have to follow, in order to come up with whether that is balanced? Because you've mentioned balanced quite a lot. But, from my point of view, sitting here, I'd be like, well, I'm not sure that is balanced, because actually there is too much left to secondary legislation there, which won't be appropriately scrutinised. So I'm just wondering if there is sort of a flowchart you have to follow that can give you that assurance that in your own minds, that what you're talking about is balanced.
When I touched on earlier in relation to the steps that we have to follow and the guidance, we do have guidance in relation to that, which sets out the consultation and the steps that we should be taking in relation to that as well. of course, again, I believe that the balance that we have is correct. I understand that some stakeholders disagree with that, as I've seen in the correspondence the committee's received as well. But I hope I've been able to outline, I think, the rationale for the approach that we've taken. And we've set out some of that in the policy memorandum, the delegated powers memorandum as well, as to how we've come to that conclusion, various other options that we've considered and why we've taken the approach that we have. So I would hope that when you consider all that information in the round, you can see why we've taken forward the position that we have in relation to the overall policy as well as to the specific instruments that we have here.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other questions? No. Okay. Okay, with that, Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much to yourself and also to your officials for your evidence this morning. The committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the session. So thank you very much. And with that, I'll move the committee into private.